Hey, I believe we're live. I've got a new co-presenter today. Jumped in my lap right before we started live. And hey, before I get started officially, if you can hear me, go ahead. If you can hear and see me, go ahead and type it into the Q&A or the chat box to make sure that everyone out there can hear me okay. So if that's the case, just let me know. I'll be looking out for that. I'm assuming everybody can. I haven't done anything different today, but I always like to make sure before we get started to make sure that everyone can hear and see me. All right. Yep. Looks like we got a good crowd on hand today. So let me get everything sort of clicked up here where I need it and get it started. And we'll get going really quick. Okay, here we go. Hey, thanks for everyone for joining us on the webinar today. My name is Russell Graves. It's a beautiful day here north of Dodge City, Texas. We got a little bit of rain yesterday, which is great for this time of year in Texas. And cool front that came through really cooled off the temperatures. We were in the mid to upper 90s with a lot of humidity all last week. And then with that cool front coming through, I think the high today is supposed to be 82 or 83. So it's just perfect here today. And what a great day to do our latest webinar here at Backcountry Journeys, video for the wildlife photographer. And to start off this presentation, again, I'll tell you the format of it. And again, I want this to be a dialogue instead of a monologue. So as I go through everything, feel free to pop in your questions. Let me know if you have any specific questions about anything I'm talking about or anything to add for that matter. I may not cover it all today. So today's webinar is just going to be sort of an overview of video for wildlife photography and, you know, kind of I'll tell you my story of why I started shooting more and more video every time I go out and just some things to think about so you can start your journey. Not only shooting wildlife photos, but also shooting video as well. And then I'll talk about a couple of little tips and techniques you can use along the way. But again, I want this to be a dialogue, not a monologue. So feel free to jump in with any questions or comments that you have. You know, my story is pretty simple. Back, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, someone can correct me on that. When Canon came out with the Canon 5D Mark II, all of a sudden we've got a really nice DSLR in our hands that, oh, by the way, we'll also shoot high def video. That kind of changed the game for me. I started seeing the power in being able to, when I'm out photographing animals, not only to take still pictures of wildlife, but also shoot video and be able to capture that behavior in a way that I never had really tried to before. I've had a video camera for a while, but the old video cameras I had were pretty cumbersome. I think it was a Canon XA10. A dedicated high def video camera. It took tapes and it was a big camera and it was a little harder to use. It wasn't difficult to use, but it was a little harder because it just meant I had to carry one more extra set of stuff. But when all of a sudden we had this convergence of video and still technology and every camera that we carry nowadays also has the ability to shoot video, that's when it started making me think different about shooting video on some of these trips that I do and some of these outings that I do. And so ultimately, why shoot video? You know, give you multimedia clips for presentations. I know I talked to several photographers that go out with us on these backcountry journey trips, and they'll tell us they get asked to do presentations at various events, whether it be civic clubs or whatever else around there, or camera clubs within their community. And the cool thing about multimedia video clips is it allows you to not only show a still picture of the animal, but also be able to show the behavior of the animal when it's in action. For example, like these salmon on the salmon run up in Alaska. Not only do I have stills of it, I've also got video of it too. And again, these aren't long clips, just short clips. By the way, before I get any further, let me back up and say the kind of the format of this is going to be, it's not going to be an in-depth dive on shooting video for a wildlife photographer. You know, video is like photography. It's an acquired art, and it takes a little bit of effort to get really, really, really good at it. I'm not saying I'm really, really good at it. I am saying that I have developed a skill set that, you know, the videos I've shot have been used not only to produce video for regional and national television, but also from time to time, clips of mine get used in various outlets. And so, you know, but again, I've got a long way to go on my video skills. But again, this presentation is going to be just sort of the basics to kind of get you acquainted with some of the things that I think about when I go out and shoot video, and some of the things that you need to think about when you go out and shoot video. And I'll supplement it. I've got a couple of short videos in between to show you how I kind of marry the two, how I kind of marry the still and the video part of what I do when I'm in the field, and put them together to make it make sense for not only the storytelling I'm doing, but also other people when they want to keep up with what I'm doing. So, So it makes it great to use multimedia clips for various presentations that you may do. Also, it's kind of neat recording behind the scenes video. That's sort of a side project I have. It's called the Wildlife Photo Show. And a lot of what I do is educational in nature and also informative in nature, but it gives me a chance to record sort of behind the scenes about what I'm seeing when I'm not just shooting still pictures. Really works good for longer personal projects. You know, one of the things that really got me interested in shooting video and really doing multimedia stuff a long time ago was there was a website that I probably ran into back in the mid 2000s. And I'm going blank on what the website is right now. But anyway, they were a real advocate of hybrid journalism, really journalism for the next journalism model, which would be on the online version. And so what they would do is they'd do long form interviews of their subjects, but they'd supplement it with still photos. Think about if you've ever listened to NPR, All Things Considered, on the radio. So NPR, I've always been fascinated with the way they tell stories. They'll tell stories with a narrator, first person interviews, and then they supplement it with the real sounds that are around them. Well, this outlet was interested in doing that model, but also including still photos in the mix. And so I really became interested in doing that. And so from that, I started doing longer personal projects. I started interviewing people that I know and just kind of getting still pictures of them and shooting audio and combining kind of a multimedia project in a video ultimately. And then from that, I started supplementing not only the still pictures, but also including video in it as well. And a lot of that culminated, I wrote a magazine article about 10 years ago for a magazine here in Texas, or wrote and photographed a magazine article. And so when I finished the article, I realized that I'd shot video along the way too, because that's when that Canon 5D came out. I'd shot video along the way, and I realized with the magazine article, I had essentially a documentary script. And so from there, I started trying to put together this documentary film. It's called Bodark Goodbye, and it was about how a lake was going to displace a bottomland hardwood ecosystem. And it's the area where I grew up, and so it's kind of a personal story. And so that longer personal project turned into a documentary film, which turned into the first ever piece I got aired to a national audience on television. And, you know, frankly, it's another medium in which to enjoy the outdoors. You know, it's in today's video driven age, you know, a picture's worth 1,000 words, but a video may be worth 10 times that. You know, it's just another medium that you can be in the outdoors, share in the outdoors. Sometimes that, you know, for me, I may not want to shoot still photos, or the opportunity may not be good to shoot still photos, but it still works for video. Because here's the thing. And some may argue at this point, but in my opinion, when you shoot video, you can get by with a little more leeway than you can shooting still photographs. So in other words, if an animal's further away than you would normally take a picture, let's say a coyote's way out in the field, but he's hunting for mice or for ground squirrels or something like that. You know, for me, as a still photographer, I want to be really close to that animal. But sometimes I can't be. And so if you shoot video of it, which shows the animal kind of moving about a larger sort of environment around it, in my opinion, shots like that work better in video than they necessarily do in still photographs. And so, again, shooting video just gives me another medium to enjoy the outdoors. And so all these scenes you see right here, I also have video clips of them in the background. And before we go any further, I'm going to show you one way that I hybridize everything. So I've got to click over here. So I've got a short video I'm going to show you, and it'll show kind of the hybrid. Well, I'm going to wait on those. I'm going to go through the points first and show you just both videos at the end. And that way I don't have to do so much clicking around. And so to get started in video, you obviously need some basic equipment. And fortunately for probably most everyone listening to today, that basic equipment is stuff you already have, with the exception of maybe one or two things. You need a DSLR or a mirrorless camera. I forgot to include that, with video capabilities. And they have wonderful video capabilities to right now. Or you need a dedicated video camera. I actually use both. I've got a dedicated video camera. It's a small, I think I misspoke earlier. I said my first video camera was an X-A10. That's my latest video camera, which is a Canon. I've got a dedicated video camera. It's a small HD camera that I can actually mount on top of my digital SLR when I'm shooting with my big telephoto lens and shoot both scenes at the same time. And that's one of the things I'm going to show you on the video in a minute, of sort of how that works in the scenes you get. Again, DSLR or a mirrorless with video capabilities, or a dedicated video camera. Either one works great. Of course, a tripod. You know, one of the things that is changing the game a little bit, but I'm still not convinced you don't need a tripod, is that these mirrorless cameras with the in-body stabilization, they make hand-holding a lot more smoother and easier when you're shooting video. But I can tell you this, nothing ruins video than a shaky video. So I'm always an advocate of using a tripod. Even when I'm shooting still pictures, I still use a tripod as much as I can. And video is no exception. And then you need a computer equipped with photo editing, like iMovie or Windows Video Editor. I know I use Mac. It comes standard with iMovie. I think the Windows machines come standard with the Windows Video Editor. That's a good jumping off place just to assemble clips. As you become more advanced in your video editing, which the video editing for me is the hardest part and it's the most time consuming part. I like shooting the video. I don't like editing the video. But if you start getting more advanced in your skill set, you know, you can opt for a program like a Final Cut Pro for the Mac, or either or Adobe Premiere, either for the Mac or for the PC. I know a lot of people use Adobe Premiere. That seems to be the industry standard. I use Final Cut Pro because I got certified on that a long time ago, back when Apple still did software certification on Final Cut Pro. And so that's the platform that I learned on. So that's just the platform I stick with. But I know there's other options available too, as far as editing platforms. But for starters, your computer probably already has a good video editing option on it as well. One thing all these pictures you see have in common is I shot video right alongside the same time I was shooting these clips. And let's talk about video terms just a little bit. And I'm going to go through the whole thing, because I don't want to make the assumption that everybody knows these things. So this won't take very long to explain. But I think it still bears mentioning what each one of these terms mean when you see video. So SD video, that's standard definition. That's what we were using commonly a dozen years ago. If you think about it in terms of still photographs, it's 640 pixels or less than 640 pixels wide. And so typically it was more of a 4x3 frame, just like you're used to seeing still photographs in standard definition. Doesn't look as good when you look at it on a high def television. Then we move into high definition, 720 to 1280 pixels wide. You know, that first digital SLR that I had that shot video, that's what it shot, would shoot in high definition. I believe it was 1280 pixels wide, what it would do. I might be wrong about that. But anyway, a pretty big step up in video quality from what you would get in standard definition. Now, in my opinion, shooting video, you can make these changes in your camera, but shooting video is, you can always shoot at the highest resolution and and output it with a lower resolution, but you can't go back and do it the other way. So just like shooting still photos, I'm always a fan of shooting raw images. And then if I need to make a smaller JPEG, I can, but it's hard to shoot a small JPEG and make it into a raw image. So I always recommend shooting in the highest definition that you that your camera will allow you. And so then we move into full HD as the technology improves. And that's 920 pixels wide, up to 1920 pixels wide. And then from there, you started seeing 2K come out. And that's a little bit bigger image size. As you can see, the image size just keeps getting bigger and bigger with each iteration. And then they came into UHD, the ultra high definition, which was 2160 pixels to 3840 pixels wide. And that's when it started getting kind of interesting for me, is when the Ultra HD came out. And then, of course, you got 4K now, which is really, really common. And then you're starting to see some of the newer cameras come out with the 8K, which is 7,680 pixels wide. And here's why it becomes interesting at that point. Because then, let me back up a little bit. When you start shooting with really ultra resolution, ultra HD or 4K or 8K, and this is one of the tricks I do here, especially with underwater photography. A lot of times I may be wading in water and there's fish swimming around, and it may not be practical for me to use underwater housing or go underwater with the fish to spook them. A lot of times I will set up, I've got GoPro cameras that I shoot in about 5K. Shooting 5K, and then because the resolution is so good, I can pull still images out of the video files and use them like you see here. Now, sometimes, you know, especially if you get some motion, they're not as sharp as they might normally be with when you're shooting still photos, but they still work in a pinch. And just like that Florida gar, that was a really skittish animal I wanted to get a picture of when we did our Florida Everglades trip. And when I shot that one, I actually just set the camera at the edge of the water, underwater, and then the fish swam over to it. And I, you know, because I was rolling video, I didn't have to sit there with my finger on the trigger, but I was able to go back later and then pull the still frame out of the image and make a, it looks better when I look at it full screen. It doesn't look that great on a small screen, but it shows that gar and how they live. And I was able to get a picture of a fish that was probably a foot long, in a way that I could have never got a picture otherwise. And so that was because we're using the Ultra HD and higher video resolutions to be able to pull that out of there. You can pull still frames out on these smaller resolutions, but the fact is they don't look as good. So the higher the resolution you get, and if you think about how wide the pixels are, it's kind of the same thing with the still photograph. You know, you get into those cameras that are 7,000-8,000 pixels wide, all of a sudden that's a super high definition still image as well. Got a comment here where Keish says, as far as video editing, you can save money and go with DaVinci Resolve. Yeah, I've heard of people using that too, and that's why I mentioned earlier there's other options that you can use, and that's obviously one of them. I've heard of people using that one as well. I don't know much about DaVinci Resolve, but I do know that's an option, so thanks for that comment, Rakesh. So before we go any further, I know I'd say that to the end, but I'm going to show you a couple of examples. Let me switch over here. So what I'm going to show you is, this is a lot of what I do. Oops, hang on. This is a lot of what I do when I'm in the field shooting still pictures. I use a GoPro a lot, and then I kind of, in the end, I make a little short presentation. That's a marriage of stills, narration, and video, and just the ambient sounds all together. For this episode, I'm actually in South Central Missouri in the Ozark Mountains, and my co-pilot Ryan and I came up here to do a little bit of fishing at first, but last night some thunderstorms moved through. It rained a lot. The rivers and creeks are up, and the fishing is off for today. So instead of sitting in the cabin all day, we decided we'd get out and try to do a little bit of exploring and
and maybe do some wildlife photography. And as we're driving along this road in the mountains, we noticed that these little potholes that filled with water overnight were just full of tadpoles. And so tadpoles have to come from somewhere. And so we finally found where that somewhere was. And we found a couple of toads that were in the water. And they were laying eggs when we found them. They're laying eggs as we speak right now. The amazing thing about wildlife photography to me is it doesn't necessarily have to be all about big charismatic species like deer or elk or bear. You know, even the smallest species, there's a lot of fascination in them. We just stopped off the side of the road. Again, a little easy setup, easy thing to take a picture of, which makes a fascinating shot. Again, the male is piggybacking on the female, the bigger female below, but they've got, I guess all these are their progeny. They've got tadpoles all through all these wet potholes. And I'll have to do a little research. I'm not sure of what the lifespan is or what even the species of toad this is, but I'm guessing these tadpoles will hatch and mature pretty quickly and be able to live out life before these potholes even dry up. So we're going to get out, shoot a few more pictures of these things, and see what else we can find on this Southern Ozark adventure. You know, I never really considered myself much of a macro photographer, but here's my basic setup. It's a Canon 5D Mark II camera. I've got an older version 70-200 f/2.8 zoom on that. It's an old lens, but it still works great, so I use it on every occasion I can. And then in between the lens and the body is a 12mm extension tube. And if you've never used an extension tube before, these things are really handy. What they'll do is when you put them on the camera, between the camera and the lens, they'll let your lens focus a whole lot closer than they would normally. So in effect, it makes this 70-200mm lens a macro lens. And so to top it off, I've got an offshoot cord here, and then I hook this flash to it. It's just a Canon Speedlight 580 EX2 flash, nothing fancy. And I use the internal TTL metering and just set my camera on aperture priority, set the f-stop at probably 5.6 because I like that really shallow depth of field, and then use that flash and let the camera decide what the shutter speed ought to be. And then I fire away, and that's how I do it. It's nothing that complicated. I don't know how well you can hear me. I've got to talk loud, but in the background, you can hear all these frogs. Again, it rained earlier today, and it's got these mud puddles here in this creek bottom. And around this one little water hole where we just shot a few pictures, there's probably a dozen frogs in there trying to call one another and mate and fight and just jockey for territory. It's pretty incredible. I mean, it's a really neat thing to see if you've never seen this before. So we're going to spend a few more minutes taking pictures of these things, and we're going to turn in for the night and hopefully get up in the morning and find some more cool things to take pictures of here in the Missouri Ozarks. So that's how I do it. I mean, that's why I started shooting video when I'd go in the field like that. Now I shoot video just about every time. Before I go any further, Rakesh has a question. Where do you get your music? I used to license all of it and pay for the music. Now both Facebook and YouTube have an audio library that's free to use. And I'm not opposed to paying to licensing the music. But the problem I got into is I would pay for a legitimate license to the music, and then you'd upload it to YouTube. And then the first thing those music companies would do would say, hey, we're going to file a copyright claim. And so that would have, I would have to go back and I'd have to go
go through all the steps to prove here's my legitimate license where I paid for this music. And it just got to be a headache, and it got to be, you know, spending a lot of time on something that, you know, it's not like I've got a huge YouTube channel where I'm making a pile of, I'm not making any money off the YouTube channel. I just do it for fun and to try to get better at shooting video. But the fact is, it was causing me a lot more work than I wanted to do when I was licensing the music from these third party vendors. So I don't know, maybe a year or two ago, maybe a little longer than that, both Facebook and YouTube came out with their own audio libraries, and you'll have to search within there to find those. If not, I can find that link a little bit and send it to everybody. But they allow you to download the music in multiple genres. Not only do they have music, but they also have sound effects. I've got a longer form video I'm not going to show today, and it's about Yellowstone. It's 15 minutes long, but a lot of that you shoot video and you may not have good sound, and so you can find sounds from various sources. I'll show you an example on the next video where I use an alternative sound to fill in the blanks where I didn't have sound, just to kind of enrich the presentation a little more. But you know, presentations like I just showed you, it's not, you know, I'm not kidding myself. It's not Hollywood stuff. It's not BBC Planet Earth stuff, but it's a good way to document what I do. And, you know, I kind of look at it from a bigger picture. It's a good way to document me at this age and my son at his age when he goes out with me. And, you know, we may never make a dollar off any of it, and that's okay, but it's a good way to, you know, kind of share a family album and the things that I did at my age right now, and that my kids and grandkids will look back at one day and see what all I was able to do and what all the things that made me tick. And so, and also is recording the animals as well and the natural history of it all, and just sort of blending all those things together in a presentation that may not mean a lot to the world, but does mean something to me and my family. So I think that's of supreme importance to be able to do that. Because again, when you're a photographer, like all of us are, we're in the documentation business. I mean, we go out and we document the things we see around us in the natural world. And like I said earlier, video is just one more way of being able to document the natural world in a way that's a little more immersive, a little more kind of active, and a little more that's palatable, sort of as a do-it-yourself kind of medium, and or watch-it-yourself sort of medium. I just got a message that said no audio. So can everybody hear me? Anyway, it's kind of a watch it yourself medium. And so it's easier to watch video for people than it is to necessarily have you sit through and do a slideshow for them. Hey, I just got a message from someone saying that they have no audio. Okay, now I'm hearing that people are saying that you can hear me, so I'm not sure. Yeah, I've got several people saying they can't hear me, so I'm not sure what's going on there on the no audio part. So it may be an issue internally, or it may be an issue with the one who's saying they can't hear any audio. So, okay. All right, so I think everybody can hear me. I'll go ahead and roll on then. Let's talk about some basic techniques of doing video. Oh, by the way, before I go any further, that last video, I shot it with three cameras. I shot it with the you know, I'd mentioned before that Canon 5D Mark II. I've still got my original camera from way back when. Well, that's a replacement because I actually drowned one scuba diving one time. So that's a replacement, but I still use that camera. Some of the close-up video of the frogs that you saw, the frogs mating, was shot with a 5D Mark II. Had a couple of overhead shots I shot with the drone, but the rest of that was shot with a GoPro camera. GoPro Hero 7 is what I use. I'm actually wanting to get the Hero 9, but that 7 works great. And the cool thing about the GoPro 7 is it has a magnificent microphone. You don't have to have extra audio equipment. If things are fairly quiet around you, it picks up your audio good. And so that audio portion of that video, when I'm talking to the camera, that was actually using the in-camera audio. And also one more thing, I didn't put a slide about this because we can go into a bunch of different things, but for the most part, I shoot everything on 24 frames per second. I think that looks the best. And every now and then I'll shoot 120 frames per second if I want to shoot something slow-mo, but I am just now getting cameras that'll shoot 120 frames per second, but most of my cameras in the past, the best they would do is 60 frames a second, which didn't look as good to me. So yeah, 24 frames a second or 24 frames a second or 120 frames a second is what I do. So I just got another message from the same person saying they can't hear any audio. So I think everybody's good though that we can't hear it. So we'll keep going. Now I mentioned it again. Use a tripod, and so tripods are invaluable to use. You know, fluid heads, if you've got one, those are the best to use if you're going to dedicate to just shooting video. But one of the things, if you notice when you watch all of my videos, I don't use a fluid head that much. I've got a ball head or a gimbal head, but I'm not doing a lot of crazy pans. I'm not doing a lot of basic or different camera, you know, zooms in or zoom out. I just use sort of a basic, you know, point the camera at something, make sure it's still shoot video, then reposition, recompose, shoot again. I do that over and over and over again. That worked pretty well for me. And then Cliff had a question before we go any further. What drone is that? I use the GoPro Mavic drone. So that's the one I use. But use a tripod all the time. If you don't have a fluid head, you can get by without one. If you do have one, that's even better. But if you're doing dedicated video, but for the most part, I just use the ball head that I already have. And this is another one too. Shoot, kind of get in a habit of shooting 10 to 20 second video clips. And so what I do is a 10 second clip will allow you to do, you know, be able to break that clip down. Because most clips, if you pay attention to how videos are edited, most clips are 5 or 6 seconds. The camera rarely lingers on any one scene a long time. So if I just get in the habit of shooting 10 to 20 second video clips, that helps organize my thoughts and the shots that I need along the way. And it gives me that's kind of my sweet spot for clips, that when I'm going back and editing, I'm not having to go back and look through a really long clip. Because again, when you shoot video, and I learned this the hard way in the beginning, when you shoot video, for every second that you shoot, that's at least a second you got to go back and watch it. So it can become time consuming wading back through these videos. So usually I shoot 10 to 20 second clips. That way I can look at a thumbnail, kind of know what's in the video, and be able to scrub through it pretty quickly and find the shorter clip, edit the shorter clip out that I want to use. And then I also try to think like a movie director. If you watch every single movie that you've ever seen before, think about every single movie that you've ever seen before, and you watch movies right now, you'll see that every movie's put together the same three basic shots. They're a wide shot, and that kind of sets the scene. If you think about the last video we did, it was a really wide shot of the Ozarks that opened it. A medium shot, and that medium shot may have been me and my son together on the buggy that he was driving us around on. Excuse me. And then the close-up shot is of the frogs. And so if I think of like a movie director and I get an assemblage of these different shots, it's a lot easier in the end to go put it all together in some way that makes sense, that's not the same shot over and over and over again. So in other words, you're not using telephoto shots over and over and over and over again. And usually kind of how I work videography into my workflow is if I'm shooting a landscape, I'll get the photos are most important to me first. If I'm shooting a landscape, I'll get my landscape photos first. And because what I said earlier, you've got a little more leeway with video, I'll go back and I'll shoot a 10 to 20 second or multiple 10 to 20 second video clips after I'm done with my still photography. So it's pretty easy to work in, and I'm not, you know, because I'm not carrying a fluid head, I'm not necessarily carrying any extra equipment. I will carry that GoPro with me all over the place, but that GoPro is pretty easy to carry around, and it's really portable. And then always think about the audio. Yeah, I kind of mentioned it before that you can find audio clips, sound effects. One of the tricks I do, when I shoot video, is the audio is always going to be a little bit uneven. The audio is the part I'm worst at on shooting video, but to even out the audios and even out the the differences in the levels. I try to make them as close as I can. But one of the things I always do, and here's a trick you can do, is when you're out, let's say I'm out where those frogs were, and I did this on that video, I'm out where the frogs were, I may set the camera there and for a minute just record nothing but audio. And that way, and I'll put the lens cap on so I know what I'm doing when I look back at it. But I'll record nothing but audio, and that way you can use that audio, that background noise, the ambient noise is what it's called, and you can drop that in and anywhere along the way, and it kind of helps even everything out. Same way as music sort of keeps all the audio, all the spoken audio evened out, you can use ambient noise or ambient sounds for doing that well. So when you think about the audio, you may or may not need a dedicated mic. Sometimes I'll have a dedicated mic that I use, but a lot of times using that GoPro, it's got a pretty good built-in mic. I'll use that as well. I'll use that. But a lot of times if you're shooting in places like Yellowstone where you may see bison or coyotes or something, you've got people all around you. And so the audio doesn't really matter because you're going to hear people talking while you're shooting video. And so in that case, I think about the audio and I may get somewhere else in Yellowstone where you can't hear anybody, and I may shoot a 10 to 20 second clip or a minute long clip of nothing but the background sound. So that way I can match that background to the appropriate time when I'm shooting the video. And I will watch another video in a minute, and we may watch it a couple times. We'll watch it straight. Then I'll annotate where I might've dropped in a background sound. But you know, the background sound can be the wind. It can be, you know, you're shooting a farmyard video. It could be chickens in the background. It could be cows in the background. It can be anything. It just needs to be the ambient noise from the location that you're shooting in. And even when you think it's perfectly quiet, we don't live in a quiet world. There's always something making sound around us. And then shoot with the end in mind. And that makes it a lot easier. That's another thing I learned the hard way. When I first started shooting video, I just shoot everything. And then I'd get back and think, okay, what am I going to do with all this? How am I going to find a story in this? And so now when I go out, I shoot with the end in mind. Like on the frogs, when I realized the frogs might make a good video, I made a few notes on my phone about these are the shots I need. This is what I'm trying to accomplish. This is the narration, or, you know, they're not detailed notes, but I'm kind of making my script. This is sort of where I'm going to go. And once I have that script in mind, it's easy to go back and make a shot list. So then instead of coming back with 500 10 to 20 second video clips, at that point I may only have 30 10 to 20 second video clips, and then the video project becomes a whole lot easier to manage in the end when you start with the end in mind. And I learned that little trick, and it made sense. You know, I'm kind of slow to learning things sometimes, but when I wrote that article I'd mentioned earlier on the documentary film I did, and realized when the article was done, I had a documentary script in hand. It made it a lot easier to go back and follow the same chronology of the magazine article I did and start making notes as far as what shots I needed where. And then I just had to go fill in the blanks, and it made it a whole lot easier to film. It made it a whole lot easier to edit in the end. And it made the presentation flow a whole lot smoother in the end. And so again, shoot with the end in mind. When you do that, you end up saving yourself a lot of post-processing time and a lot of editing time. I've gotten now on those wildlife photo show videos that I showed you a minute ago. The first one I did, it literally took me 4 or 5 hours to edit it. And I knew there had to be a better way to doing it. Well, now I've gotten better at shooting with the end in mind, especially when it comes to those. And it probably takes me 30 minutes now to edit one. So I usually just sit in bed at night while my wife is watching something on TV and kind of go through it really quick and be able to whip them out pretty fast. And then one more thing you can do too, you can organize all your video files. If you use Lightroom, you can actually add keywords to those video files. So in other words, if you're wanting, I do this a lot too. I may have a video I produced a video for a company not long ago, and I shot it. I used all using stock clips I already had. I had to go shoot a little bit of video for them, but for the most part, it was stock clips I already had. And so instead of having to wade through hours and hours of video, I can go into Lightroom just like I'll find my pictures, and I've got them organized via keyword, and I can just add simple keywords to my video files and be able to find them pretty quickly. And that really makes that really helps out a lot in the end. And I, I wish you could do this in Lightroom. I don't think you can. If you can, you can correct me on this. I wish there was a way to edit down the clips and make them smaller, because invariably when I shoot video, a lot of the clips on the front end are kind of shaky, and then a lot of the clips on the back end are shaky. So that 10 to 20 seconds may be, say it's a 20-second clip, it may be 2 seconds on the front end that are unusable, 2 seconds on the back end that they're unusable, but the stuff in the middle is what I want to keep. I wish there was a way to edit those out, because I usually have to go back and still kind of pare the clip down to just the part I want. But it, using Lightroom to organize your images by keywords, organize your video files by keywords really does make a lot of difference. So let me switch over to video one more time. I'll show you another video. And again, it's another really short one. And oops, hang on, wrong video. We watched that one already. Here we go. This is the one. So before I get this started, let me just go ahead and say, when you watch this, you be listening. I mean, of course, you're going to hear the music, because I always start everything off with music. But be listening for the music, and then be listening for like the sound of wind and stuff like that, because that wasn't native to the original production. That's actually added in later to try to sort of even the audio out and mask some of the errant sounds that you may have heard in the background. So this is one called West Texas Road Trip. Oh, by the way, too, I need to mention, this is also, I should have put the name in this, but I didn't. But I've got a little ball head, tripod head. It's a little bitty, but it mounts to the hot shoe of my camera. And I can actually mount a small HD video camera to the top of my DSLR and be able to shoot, like if I'm shoot, like on this case, I'm shooting out of the window of my pickup, and I could actually shoot video at the same time I'm shooting still photos, because I'll aim the camera exactly where my camera's aiming, or I'll aim the video camera exactly where my still camera's aiming, and be able to capture both of them simultaneously. And it's how you are able to get some of the scenes that you videoed still photos as well. It's another way you can do it instead of doing just a screen grab. So let's go ahead and watch this. Watched the show before, you know one of my favorite ways to photograph wildlife is to get up in the morning and just cruise back roads where you're likely to see animals. This morning I'm out in far west Texas in the southern end of the Davis Mountains. There's all kinds of wildlife out here. There's some pronghorns in the field to my left. A little far out, there's a scaled quail on the post. So my technique is pretty simple. Just get up, drive around slow, keep my eyes open, try to find wildlife. I'm going to back that up and point this out right quick. You know, I mentioned earlier about how the cool thing about video is you can shoot scenes that work for video, but there wouldn't be as good in a still photo. On this particular scene right here, you can see the light. I mean, it's, to me, that wouldn't make a good still photo if I had shot it with my DSLR. The light is coming from a weird angle with the pronghorns. They're really far out there. And then, you know, there's a little bit of redemption, because you can kind of see the mountains and put it in the habitat, but you can see these buildings in the background, which kind of ruins it from a still photography perspective, in my opinion, but from a video standpoint, this is where video really works to capture wild animals in the wild.
A little far out, there's a scaled quail on the post. So my technique is pretty simple. Just get up, drive around slow, keep my eyes open, try to find wildlife when they're out first in the morning, moving around, trying to feed, trying to get water, and even calling for mates like the blue quail is. I'm gonna sneak back down there and see if I can get a photograph of them.
Small birds and other wildlife is sometimes hard to spot. So the best tip for cruising for wildlife is to just drive slowly. when you're photographing wildlife from a road like this, I really think it goes without saying that you got to not only have your eyes open for wildlife, but you also really need to be aware of the traffic around you. I never just pull right off the side of the road. If I'm going to pull off, I'm going to commit, get well off the road, because the last thing I want to do is to create a hazard for people who are trying to just get to work or get back to their home. So again, I try to, if I see wildlife, I'll make sure there's no cars behind me, signal plenty of time, get off the road, and just try to create a safe environment, not only for the animals, but also for me and the other people around. Just seconds later, I saw one of the animals I was seeking. Seeing those javelinas just now was a real treat. Javelinas are pretty common in Texas, but they're not real common where I live, so I never see them. I mean, maybe once a year if I'm down south or southwest, I'll see javelinas, but not that often. The crazy thing about those critters are they look like pigs, but they're not pigs at all. Javelinas are actually unique species all their own and are members of the peccary family. There are three species of peccaries that range from the southwestern U.S. to South America. The only species found in the United States is the collared peccary or javelina. Within a 2 mile stretch of road, and probably over the past half hour, I've seen pronghorn antelope, I've seen burrowing owls, a lot of different songbirds, scaled quail, javelina. But again, it just goes to show if you get out in the mornings and drive around and you just visit places where wildlife exists, you can see all kinds of stuff. And luckily for me, the javelinas and the burrowing owls and everything else, it's right alongside this highway that I'm on. Not a real busy highway at all. Matter of fact, it's hard. I've probably seen 10 cars all morning, but there's just enough cars that come by every day that the animals just get used to seeing cars. So even though when I pull off to the side of the road, they may get a little bit skittish, but as long as I move slow and I'm calm and I don't really try to make any sudden noises, and most importantly, I don't get out of the vehicle, they'll calm down, hang out like those javelinas. I mean, they're 10, 15 yards from the vehicle. And again, they knew I was there, but they just weren't very upset at the fact that I was there, and so I was able to get some pretty good shots. Right now I can hear a scaled quail. It sounds like he's behind me calling, and hopefully I'll drive back down there and find him from a fence post. But I hope you like this show. If you have any questions or comments, be sure. Okay, let me switch back over. But yeah, you can see there, if you like, in that scaled quail picture, I used just a sound I found. I was able to download from a publicly available source and be able to drop that sound in there. And when the javelina's walking around, you can't hear my camera clicking, even though it was, because I just dropped in audio over the top of that, where it would mask the sound of my camera, and you could just hear an ambient sound from around there. And I think that's my last slide. Again, this was really kind of an overview for it, but I'd encourage everybody to shoot video when you're out like that, because, you know, once you kind of get in the hang of things, it's like shooting still pictures. You start building a collection, and it just, again, another interesting way to help tell your story when you're in field. Does anybody have any questions at all? Just go ahead and drop them in there. I think I answered. I've got one question showing up. I think I answered already with Cliff asked, what drone is that? I believe I answered that, but if I didn't, it's a DJI Mavic Pro drone that I used on that video. All right, I don't see any more questions coming in. If anybody has any questions or comments beyond this presentation, feel free to reach out to me. My email address is russell@russellgraves.com. I'll go back all the way to the front. It's just my first, Russell, my first name, and then at russellgraves.com in the end. And then I had a I had Mark ask a question about, will you offer up a webinar about the polar bear trip? And, okay, we got some questions coming in now. And the answer to your question, Mark, about the polar bear trip is we don't have it slated yet, but that doesn't mean anything. We certainly could do that. And I'll make note that you're interested in that. So we sure may be bringing you a polar bear webinar here soon. Got a few questions coming in here. So Charles asked the question, do you use full frame or crop? You know, I've got both, so I use whatever camera I have with me. You know, I shoot anywhere from on the videos that I shoot in with cameras 5D Mark II, which is full frame. I shoot a lot of the wildlife videos because that's the camera I prefer using. I've got a 1D Mark IV camera that shoots video. That's a little bit of a crop. It's a 1.3 crop. I use that. I recently picked up a Canon 90D camera because it shoots 4K. And that's absolutely crop. So I shoot, you know, depends on what camera I have is what I shoot. And then I had a question here. What lens do you use most for video? Well, the answer to that is it depends. Most of the wildlife shots you see, I'm using a 500 millimeter lens for that because I'm usually shooting pictures at the same time I'm shooting video. The I'd mentioned before the when I'm filming myself talking, I'm using a GoPro to shoot that. And so it really depends, everything in between. I'll use a 70. I don't have a lot of lenses. I've got a 16 to 35 millimeter zoom I use. I've got a 70 to 200 millimeter. And I've got a 500 millimeter. I've got some lenses in between that, but that's my basic camera setup that I use 90% of the time are those three lenses that I use. Judy asked, what edit software do you use? I use Final Cut Pro. Judy, I'd mentioned that, you know, if you've got a Mac, iMovie comes on Mac or Windows has a built-in software program. I can't remember what it is. But, you know, someone mentioned DaVinci Resolve. I use Final Cut Pro. I know a lot of guys use Adobe Premiere. And so there's a lot of different in Adobe Premiere. I think also has a Premiere's Elements. That's a little bit lighter version. There's a lot of different options you can use for that. You appreciate it, Jeff. Jeff just said, thanks for the knowledge. Oh, okay. So the person that asked what lens I use, I didn't mention his name because he didn't type his name in there, is Tommy. Hey, Tommy, hope you're doing well. Thanks, Don and Needy, for your comments there. And if anybody else have any comments, we're scheduled for an hour. We've got about 7 more minutes left. But if anybody else has a question or comment, I'd be happy to answer it. And again, I'll just kind of, as I talk and ramble on towards the end of this, I'll just go through this again if it spurs any questions, or I'll just go through without talking about the bullet points. If it spurs any questions, you can certainly answer it. Again, I want to mention this point again on grabbing steel frames. Man, that's a valuable asset right there, especially. And again, these are from GoPros. I've had these steel frames from GoPros in large and double page spreads and magazines. And so they really, really, really work good. You've got plenty of resolution for a bigger picture. You know, can you blow it up to 30 by 40? Maybe not, but for, you know, the screen size on your computer, it's going to look pretty good. But again, pictures like this, I've shot pictures like this using underwater housing and using my digital SLR, but it's so cumbersome, but in a pinch. And I actually did this trip last fall when the salmon were running at Katmai on the Katmai trip. I just put that GoPro on a tripod head, stuck it underwater, held it underwater, and let the fish swim by. And then I go back and I find the scene that looks best and then pluck that one frame out of there. And it's a pretty good way to capture a picture in a way that's it's a pretty good way to capture pictures like that in areas that almost otherwise be impossible to do. I had another question come in. Real fast, let me look at that. Oops. There's not a question, just a comment. Again, that gar picture there, same way. And that mud, water is a little muddy. That's why it looks like that. I'd mentioned it before. It looks better when I see it bigger. It's pretty small on my screen. It's bigger than that. When I see this presentation on my screen, it's bigger than what you can see here. It looks better than that. But the fish lives in muddy water. So that I was just proud to get a picture of it. I shot pictures of these roseate spoonbills on the Everglades trip, and what was remarkable about that is one of the guests let me borrow their Canon R5 and the ability for the R5 to autofocus on the moving subjects going straight at you like that. It's a game changer. I'm waiting on the new Canon R3s to come out, and when I get those, it's really going to change the game on how I look at video and how I shoot video. So Mark had a question related to the polar bear trip. Longest telephoto lens recommendation for the polar bear trip. You know, usually on almost every trip we take, I take a 500 millimeter lens, and you can see these three pictures on the screen right there were shot with a 500 F4, and I put a 1.4 converter on it if I need to. And all these pictures were taken with that. So that's what I would recommend, somewhere in the 500 to 600 millimeter range. And the part about using the tripod, again, can't tell you enough good things about doing that. You always need to use a tripod when you're shooting video. Now, I think that's it. I didn't have any more questions come in. So I appreciate everyone's time. Appreciate everyone attending this, listening to this. I'm glad we've got a great community here, and I'm glad everyone takes the time to jump in on these webinars. I know next week I'm not doing a webinar. There's going to be a presentation about a trip announcement next week. A new trip, Backcountry Journeys, has coming out. But I know looking at my schedule, aside from being in the field in the middle part of July, I've got a pretty busy webinar schedule coming up. So if you like what I have to say and you enjoy listening to me drone on in my Texas accent about all the things that I know and love to share about, feel free to join in anytime you get a notification. And in the meantime, again, if you have any questions, once this webinar is over, feel free to reach out to me, Russell@RussellGraves.com. Sometimes I'm a little slow at it, but I always answer emails. So, and always enjoy the banter back and forth with everybody and getting to learn about what motivates everyone else in the field. So, with that being said, thanks everyone for your questions. Thanks everyone for your comments. I really appreciate it, and have